Sorry to keep you, but since you're in the building...
That's Matron. And Mr. Rose.
No trouble, Matron.
You can't possibly know that.
Yes, I can. There's no authority in them footsteps.
Don't half smell down here.
That's the dust of ages, that is, lad.
Smells more like mice to me.
Don't be daft. Right, well, I'm off for my tea. We'll sort that valve out in the morning.
Get off! Get off! Sister, the spiders, thousands of them.
So, poor man has a high fever. The green grass.
This one.
Spiders,
this one.
Indeed. On my word, goodness, whatever next. There's no sign of Mr. Greengrass's rigorous abating or the delirium. He was just telling the whole world he could see spiders.
Yes, well, it's probably falciparum and malaria. It's resistant to quinidine.
Oh, really?
I've ordered a new drug from the pharmacy. It'll be here tomorrow. So start him on that and we'll see how we get on. In the meantime, just keep him cool with a fan and keep his fluid levels up.
Yes, but...
I'm sorry, sister. No buts. I'm so late you wouldn't believe. Good night.
Good night, Doctor.
Headache?
No.
Vomiting?
No.
Good as new, I say. No problem.
The knee's still very sore.
Yes, of course it is. You've torn every ligament you've got. Talk to Matron about it. My concern is the state of your skull. All things being equal, I think you can chuck him out of here in 48 hours.
Thank you.
Cheerio.
Am I really ready to go home?
If Mr. Rose says so. You'll be on crutches for a while, of course. It might be easier if your wife makes up a bed for you downstairs.
What?
And will that be difficult?
Won't have to be, won't it?
Lorry driver says they've opened up the corner a bit wide and the lad skidded. He was thrown clear. But the driver reckons he saw the last go straight into the wall.
How long ago?
20 minutes.
Hello?
I'm Dr. Ormerod.
Get into the hospital. Any identification?
Passports and everything.
Came off a motorbike. Boy was unconscious for approximately 20 minutes. The girl has major trauma to the head. Possible internal injuries.
Right, put the girl in the emergency operating theatre. I'll get the boy in the treatment room.
Lizzie, could you call my wife, please? Tell her I've got an emergency.
Hey.
Now, the relatives have been informed. They'll be here soon. Could you please stay and look after them?
Yeah, of course.
Thank you.
Hello there. Can you hear me? Can you tell me what your name is?
Where's Laura?
Multiple abrasions to scalp. Pupils dilated and not responding. She's bleeding from the left ear, and I think there's a probable middle cranial fossa fracture. OK, check BP and get X-ray in here straight away.
Can you make a fist for me, Brian? OK, good.
Please. Where's Laura?
It's just on the other side of that wall. She's been very well looked after.
Fracture of left scapula and left clavicle. Left side hemothorax. All ribs on left side fractured.
Blood pressure very low.
Abdomen's distended. Probable rupture of liver and spleen.
It's no trouble, honestly. Let me make you a nice cup of tea. It'll be a while before the doctors have anything to tell you.
Please, find out about Laura.
As soon as I've sorted you out, okay? I'm going to keep you in for a couple of days. Do some x-rays, just to be on the safe side. But I think that you haven't done anything more than give yourself some nasty cuts and bruises, so you're a very, very lucky young man. Dr. Omrod.
Frankly, with these injuries, I'm amazed she lasted as long as she did. Time of death, 1855.
My mother's outside.
Okay. Can you tidy her up a little bit, please?
She would have felt no pain, Mrs. Galbraith. She wouldn't have known anything about it.
Can I see her?
Well, if you'd like to.
He's all right.
Yes, yes,
he is. How can he be all right when Laura's dead?
Look, he's okay.
He's not! He's got no right being alive! He should have been killed, not my Laura!
I'm so sorry.
Just come and sit down.
Murderer!
Now, come on.
Look, I know this is a terrible time for both of you.
And it's all her fault! Jeez.
Has Mr. Gordon's wife been in to visit him at all since he's been here?
No, she hasn't. No, he mentioned it.
Is it important? I need to know what kind of home care's available to him when he leaves us.
He doesn't seem to want to talk about it. Maybe Dr. Omrod could have a word. He's good at that sort of thing.
Right. Let's give that old boiler a good talking to.
I'm freezing. I can't get warm.
You take these pills and you'll be as warm as toast. The doctor got them in specially for you.
Yes, well, as much as we enjoy your company tremendously, you really can't stay here forever, you know.
Just another week. Just till I feel a bit stronger.
Yes, well, just lying around here is not going to get you any stronger, is it? And that knee needs time to mend. And we've got to get your other muscles up and working again. And I'm sure your wife would love you to be back home as soon as possible, wouldn't she?
I doubt it.
Is your wife perhaps not cut out to be the old ministering angel?
Don't know what she's cut out to be anymore, that's the truth of it. When I fell down them stairs, she just stood there. As the neighbour called the ambulance, she'd taken herself off to bed.
I'm sorry, Dennis. I don't mean to pry. I really am only trying to help.
Then let me stay a bit longer. Please, Doctor, don't send me home just yet. I can't face it. I don't think I can take it anymore.
One gold locket on a chain. One wristwatch. One engagement ring.
It's not her ring. She went engaged.
She was wearing it.
You can keep it then. She's not touching it. She's not taking anything off that.
I'll keep it here in case you change your mind. Mrs. Gilbraith, I'm afraid there's going to have to be a coroner's inquest before we release.
Does that mean a post-mortem?
All right. I'll take you down to my office and see if we can find us both a cup of tea.
For thine is the power and the glory for all eternity. Amen.
Amen.
For the soul of poor little Laura and for her poor demented mother.
I heard what happened in casualty last night. I'm so sorry. It must have been dreadful for you both. Grief is a terrible thing.
We shall strive to find grace through it.
Brian, I need to take your pulse.
When can I go home?
Not for a bit. You bumped your head, see, so we need to keep an eye on you.
Okay.
Meanwhile, you seem to be doing fine, though. Were you off on holiday?
No.
She was my life. I only ever wanted the best for her. They offered her a place at Cambridge, you know.
Really?
Physics. She'd have been the only female student in the entire year.
Clever girl, eh?
That's what I didn't understand. I mean, she'd watch me mess me chances with a deadbeat, and yet she couldn't wait to do the same with that useless Linson boy. She wouldn't see reason.
Well, people in love rarely do.
Love? She was 18. What would she know about love?
I'm going to give you some ointment for that eczema of yours, and I'm going to prescribe a mild sedative just so that you get a bit of sleep, all right?
And will Laura be there when I wake up?
Hey, what's going on?
That's been chewed, that has.
I told you I could smell mice.
You will keep biscuits in your pockets.
Not my fault.
Right, well, never mind that now. If we have got mice, there'll be both our heads on the block. So forget the boiler. Gotta find out how many of the little blighters we've got.
April of this year, a scald to the lower abdomen. Said he knocked a pot off the cup. February before that, a deep gash to the forearm. Christmas before that, a black eye.
You're not seriously suggesting that Mrs. Cording inflicted those injuries, are you?
Well, all I know is that the man's desperately upset at the thought of going home. And quite honestly, these are the classic sort of injuries that do come from violence.
Mm. And him a grown man.
It does happen, Matron. I mean, I hope I'm wrong, but you do understand my concern.
I do, yes. Maybe I should have a word with her.
Is that wise?
Whether you're right about this or not, I've still got to make the home call. Mr. Cording's going to be on crutches for quite a while. Leave it with me. I'll see what I can find out.
Thanks.
Sister Bridget.
In a minute, Mr. Greengrass.
What are you doing, Ken?
Nothing, Matron.
It hardly looks like nothing.
Just checking the pipes under the shelves, Matron.
What for?
Oh, usual quarterly check.
Can I carry that for you?
I'm only going to put them in the steriliser for tomorrow. You all right, Alan?
Yeah. I'm just looking for something.
Earn your report for tomorrow's list.
How's Brian Linson this morning?
As well as can be expected. Thank you, staff. David, I had a similar incident to you yesterday. I came across a road accident on my way home.
How was it bad?
Well, in this case, it wouldn't have made any difference if I'd had the equipment or not, but it made me think. Have you heard of a chap called Ken Easton? Apparently he's working on something similar over at Catterick. Mm. He calls it immediate care.
Yeah, I know.
Absolutely appalling, really.
What?
Well, something so obvious as having an emergency kit on hand when you actually need it. I mean, why haven't we been doing that for years? I mean, that's what's appalling.
I can't believe you were going to elope. Running away abroad.
We weren't going abroad. We just thought we might need passports for identification.
At a registry office. You must have known I'd never have recognised that sort of marriage.
Yeah.
But you were going to do it anyway. Is that what she wanted you to do? Abandon...
Stop it! What does it matter now, anyway? She's dead. I loved her more than anything in the world, and now she's gone. Can't you just leave it at that?
Marjorie. I'm so sorry. I know you think... Perhaps if I hadn't forbidden them to see each other.
I don't blame you. I'm sorry for what I said last night. I'm very glad you're alive and unhurt.
Thank you.
I loved her so much.
Good. I hope you have a very long life, Brian. because I want you to live every day of it suffering your loss, as I shall suffer mine. You and your precious faith. This is where hell is, Mrs. Linson. Right here.
Yesterday, all my troubles seem so far away. Now it looks as though they're here to stay. Oh, I believe in yesterday. Suddenly, I'm not half the one I used to be. There's a shadow hanging over me. Oh, yesterday came suddenly. Why he had to go, I don't know.
Mrs. Cording? Hello?
I said something wrong. Now I long for yesterday.
Good.
See what all this fuss is about.
Oh,
here's a thing.
You were wrong, weren't you? I've not got malaria at all. I mean, malaria don't do this, does it?
Oh, no, you've got malaria all right, Mr. Greengrass. It's just that now you have a nice rash to go with it. Now, I wonder what you did to deserve that.
Come in here.
Have you ever read any of Michael Ballant's papers? Tavistock Clinic.
Not word for word, no.
That's very interesting. He says that we should consider our patients as having three separate but interlocking aspects to their lives, right? Social, physical and psychological.
Yep, I'm with you so far.
And because they are like interlocking circles, if something goes wrong with one of the aspects, then it has an effect on the others, so that sometimes what presents itself as a medical problem may well have its origins elsewhere. Do you see what I mean?
If that was true, I would have been presented with a screaming abdabs years ago.
Talking about Mrs. Galbraith, I think her eczema is a symptom of something else, you know. I think she was a deeply neurotic woman way before this tragedy with her daughter.
Sister Bridget says, could you take a quick look at Mr. Greengrass, please? He's come out all spotty.
Now, what's that a symptom of, do you think?
Being a pain in the backside.
Right, well, there's no mice on the wards.
There's no sign of casualty.
Right, well, that just leaves the outbuildings and the attic. You set some traps down here and I'll go check the other places. If they're only in the cellar, with a bit of luck, we might just have got away with it.
Right. It's really rather decorative when you look at it from the right angle.
That's very droll.
Anyway, it's only hives.
Hives?
Probably just a nasty allergic reaction to that new drug we started you on. Which is a shame, really, because it seems to be getting to grips with your malaria. Anyway, Sister Bridget is going to swipe some more of your blood for a parasite count.
Oh, yeah. Won't have any left at this rate.
Yes, well, I'm sure you'll be able to manage something. And if you ask her very, very nicely, she might be able to give you something nice and soothing for the rash.
I hope it's not too newfangled. Not if it does this to you. I'll finish up with a rash somewhere else.
Yes, well, we use a very advanced formula, Mr. Greengrass. It's what we in the medical profession call calamine lotion.
Not too deep, will it?
The long and the short of it is, we can't rely on Mrs. Cording to even be there, let alone care for her husband when he goes home.
And Dennis has no idea what's been happening.
Perhaps you could tell him.
Me?
If you're not in too much of a hurry to get home, of course.
Hiya.
Hi.
Can I do something for you?
Oh, yes. Well, it's a bit confidential, really.
Dr. Cheriton, in my job, I have to be the very soul of discretion.
Good. Right. Well, it's about staff nurse Taylor.
Yeah?
I was just wondering, is nurse Taylor attached?
Attached? Attached to what?
Well, I mean, is she, you know, walking out?
Walking out? You mean she's packed in a job? Well, it's first I've heard of it, if she is.
No, I don't mean that.
Ever such a nice girl, Meryl. I'm surprised she doesn't have a boyfriend. But there we are. Probably waiting for Mr. Wright to come along.
I'm not sure I care where she's got to.
Things that bad?
I wouldn't know where to start. Here. That's her, a couple of years ago, on her 50th birthday.
She's a handsome woman.
Aye, she was. Before she stopped smiling once and for all. Oh, and I know women of that age go through a, well, difficult time. Try to be patient.
Didn't you try to talk to her about it?
No. There didn't seem to be any point. She just started, I don't know, switching off. She stopped listening to me, she stopped talking to me. Quite frankly, Doctor, I was so glad of the peace and quiet, I just didn't want to rock the boat anymore.
Oh. I'm sorry.
We used to be so in love. Who'd have thought it had come to this, eh?
Excuse me, Doctor. Did you see where Brian Linson went to?
What do you think you're doing out there? Come on. Hey. We'll have them slates fixed last week, sir.
Go away.
Come on, lad. Now, if you lose your balance, you're going to do yourself a real mischief.
You can't stop.
Yes, I can. Now, come on, get down. Come on, you.
Oh. Oh. Oh, heavens.
Are you okay?
Here, is it?
Ken, you're not throwing chimney pots off the roof again, are you?
I slipped and just froze. I can't get him to move.
Ken, can you do me a favour? There's a sink in the sluice room blocked up. Can you take a look at it for me?
Yes.
Right. Got a good hold of you. We need to hurry. Take a step with me. Right, I've got a hold of you. That's it. And one more. Come in. I'm coming.
You sit down and get your legs back for a bit. All right?
Aye.
Well done. That could have been nasty. How did you know he was... Look, do you want to talk about it here, or should we go somewhere more comfortable?
I'm gonna get some help.
Then will my lover return to me? You must never take an attempted suicide lightly.
I'm not. I just think that if he was so easily distracted when he saw that Ken needed help, he couldn't have been that focused on killing himself. And he did come down without any argument.
What do you think, sister? Well, I wasn't there, obviously, but I tend to agree. He's just suffered a terrible tragedy. And the things that girl's mother was saying to him on the ward. Wicked, dreadful things. Anyone would be devastated.
So you think this was a temporary derangement? It was a passing impulse?
He's not mentally ill. He's heartbroken.
Look, he's from a church-going family. Let me have a word with him.
You give that back to him when you do.
Come along, what are you sitting around for? Doesn't anybody do any work in this place? What have you got for me?
Sir? Appendectomy, hernia, ingrained toenail, and a varicose vein.
Good, I'll do the hernia first. Thought any more about my offer?
Sir?
Coming round to the general and working for me there.
I'm quite useful here, sir.
Small beer, young man, small beer.
Throat is again, sister.
Yes, Mr. Greengrass.
Sister, I'm telling you the truth. There's a flaming mouse on the top of the curtain rail.
Yes, and I'm the queen of the May.
I'm being serious.
Mr. Greengrass, You have been delirious, but you're not delirious anymore because your treatment's working quite nicely. And if you're trying to pull a fast one, I'd appreciate it if you'd be a bit more original.
But... Ken, come in. Hey, you could see it, can't you?
See what, Mr. Greengrass?
The mouse! Look,
will you not try a bite to eat?
Blood. Can't see it, there's too much blood. Sucker, please.
It doesn't seem to be here, Mr. Rose.
Then find it. Pop that business.
Hey, Alan, I've just seen one of them.
Can't stop, I'm looking for the sucker, sorry.
Another hot pack, please, staff. That's it. Pack him like a teddy bear.
Got the sucker, Mr. Rose.
And about time.
Don't seem to be working, Mr. Rose.
Fresh hot packs, please, staff nurse Taylor.
I know what it's like to love someone so much you can't conceive of not being with them all the time.
But you're talking about God. Laura and me, we were like two halves of the same person.
Does that have to change?
Yeah, of course it does.
Physically, perhaps. But wasn't your love so special because it was a spiritual union, a meeting of two souls.
Yeah, it was.
Well then.
Yeah, I know all that, but the rest of my life. So long a time to be without her.
Then you must have courage, Brian.
Do you really think we'll meet again in paradise?
Have you stopped believing it?
I don't know. I can say all the right words, but it's not as easy as that, is it?
There's nothing in the book that says it's going to be easy. Trust in the Lord, Brian. Now's the time you need your faith more than anything. It'll help, I promise.
I wish at this moment I could believe. I can think of nothing I'd like better than to know she was with some kind of loving God. I wish I could believe there was someone up there who could make it easier for me. That's why Brian's mother banned them from seeing each other, you know. Thought we were godless atheists. But you can't force belief, can you?
It's not my province, Mrs. Galbraith. My job is to promote healing.
And how do you heal a wound like this?
I don't know. Perhaps the first step is not to make it any worse.
How much worse can it be?
A great deal. We found Brian on the hospital roof last night. We think he may have been considering suicide. Mrs. Galbraith. There's more than enough pain for you all as it is. Laura loved him enough to want to marry him. Can you not find it in you to make your peace with him and his mother, if only for her sake?
Oh, my little girl.
Physically, he's fine, Mrs. Linson. She'll be allowed to go home by the end of the day.
Oh, thank you, Doctor.
I am, however, a little bit concerned about his state of mind.
Why?
Well, it's a terrible thing to lose the love of your life.
I do know that, Doctor. I lost my own husband 5 years ago.
Right, well, then you'll appreciate the sort of
depression, really, that can accompany this sort of grief.
Of course. When Brian's father died, without the love of my family and the support of my church, well, I don't know what I'd have done. As long as that Gilbraith woman keeps her evil tongue to herself, then my son will manage just fine.
Mrs. Linson, that Gilbraith woman has lost an awful lot more than you have, and I gather she has less support than you, so, I don't know, a little bit of Christian charity, maybe?
Oh, Brian, you look so much better.
I'm okay. Sister Bridget's a very special person.
Mel, just lean forward. There we go.
Oh, isn't he?
Do we have any idea who she is?
Well, not unless there's anything in her bag over there.
I'll ring round the institutions as soon as I get a minute.
It's probably a good idea. She's suffering from hypothermia.
Just rubbish. Bits of newspaper. Shopping list. Good Lord. The address on this envelope, that's where I was yesterday. It's where Dennis Gording lives. That can't be Mrs. Gording, can it?
No. No, this isn't her. Her husband showed me a photograph of her yesterday. You said a door was open. I think this poor soul just wandered in off the street and started to pinch his stuff. Yes, all right. I'll tell him about that as well. In the meantime, start warming her up and, get some fluids inside her.
Sister.
Yes?
What exactly did you say to Brian?
Less than 24 hours ago, he was threatening to throw himself off the roof. Now look at him.
Looking forward to getting out of this place.
Well, grief can shake faith very badly. Sometimes all that's needed is a little reminder of where your strength comes from.
The future doesn't look as terrible as it did, that's all. Whatever you thought about Laura, we loved each other, and we always...
I'm arranging Laura's funeral for next Friday. I have no other family. Perhaps we might find it easier if we all sat together.
We might. Thank you.
I just thought it, well, it might be someone you know.
Aye, I know her. That's Betty. That's my wife.
What?
What's happened to her? Why's she in here?
How long has she been like this?
It's hard to say. She's been putting on weight and letting herself go for months.
Dennis, I think there might be something wrong with your wife that's more than just simple hypothermia.
She's gone senile, hasn't she?
Well, no. I'm not terribly sure that she has. In fact, I'm going to run some investigations, see if they'll help us.
Will she have to go into her home?
I'm sure it won't come to that. Look, don't worry. We're going to take good care of her. Nurse, while you're down here, will you make a series of physio appointments for Mr. Cording, please?
Surely.
Thank you.
What are you thinking?
Well, a breakup of a marriage does make people behave in odd ways, but it doesn't wipe them out like this. Recent weight gain, puffy face, poor eyebrows, mood changes. I think this could be fluid myxoedema. Excuse me. I'm going to catch Mr. Rose before he leaves.
Mice? What do you mean, mice?
We've been having a bit of a problem with them, Mr. Rose.
And they've obviously been having a go at some of the wiring.
May I remind you, ladies and gentlemen, that this is an operating theatre. A supposedly sterile environment where poor, benighted individuals trust me to rummage round in their innards without being overrun by vermin!
Yes, Mr. Rose, but we've seen none in here, mind.
You must be out of your mind to want to remain in a dump like this.
Yes, Mr. Rose.
Ah, Mr. Rose. All finished for the day.
What do you want?
What do I want? Well, nothing too urgent, really. I just wonder whether I could enlist your support for the idea of setting up an immediate care kit for, well, situations outside of the hospital.
Immediate care? This is where you need immediate care, Dr. Ormerod. Put your own house in order before attempting anything more difficult.
Anyone care to enlighten me?
Oh, matron. How was Mrs. Gilbraith when you took her to see her daughter?
As you'd expect, distraught. I did try to persuade her not to make things any worse, though. This feud between her and the Linson family.
Well, that obviously had an effect. She'd just been on the ward and invited them both to the funeral.
Really? Mm. And how is Brian?
Well, he's better, which does concern me, rather.
Why?
Well, he's gone from losing his girlfriend through trying to commit suicide to serene acceptance in the shortest space of time. I don't know. I think it smacks of not facing the issue, not really facing the reality of his loss.
Do you think he might try to harm himself again?
I'm not a fortune teller, and I've no evidence to suggest that he might. I'm not very happy about letting him go home so soon, that's all.
I simply can't give up a bed on the basis that someone might need psychiatric evaluation at some point.
No, I know.
You must either commit to this course of action or discharge him, I'm afraid, Dr. Wetherill.
Are you on duty tomorrow?
No. Why?
Well, I just wondered if you fancied going to the cinema. Or a drink or something.
Yeah, that'd be nice. I've been to the pictures for ages.
Right.
I need a word, Mr. Greengrass. I'm in deep trouble.
Go away and leave me alone, Ken. I'm a sick man.
I need your help.
Oh, yeah?
Well, we've got a spot to bother with the you-know-what.
I don't know what you're talking about.
It begins with M and ends in ice.
Oh, does it? Well, you haven't got a problem then, have you? Because it was just me hallucinating, wasn't it?
I couldn't say anything earlier on, could I? There were too many people listening. Now they all know.
It's about time you found out who your friends are.
Mr. Greengrass, Claude. I mean, you're a gentleman of the country, aren't you? I mean, you know about these things.
It'll cost you.
Bottle of stout?
You got more chance than it in fog. A bottle of scotch?
Half a bottle.
All right. It's a deal. There's this farmer out at Southwaite. He's got one of these, like, big smoke guns. He uses it to smoke the little devils out of his barn. That's what you need.
And?
And? That's all you're getting for half a bottle of scotch. I want the other half if you want his address.
Mel. Thanks. You off now?
Yeah.
Good luck.
Thanks.
Listen, Brian, remember, if you have any problems at all, OK, even if you just want somebody to talk to, I'm here and I'm available, OK?
You'll be fine, Doctor.
Thank you for everything, Sister Bridget.
Oh, it was nothing.
Not true. You helped me understand how important it is to trust God and be brave. Oh. Goodbye. Goodbye, Doctor. All the tests show that your wife's thyroid functions are virtually nil.
So what does that mean?
Well, apart from its role in the body, the thyroid also controls a lot of the emotions. So when the gland isn't working anymore, the physical effects are obvious. Weight gain, coarsening of the skin. What aren't so well known are the mental effects.
I thought it was early senility.
It used to be called mixoedema madness. They used to put people away for it.
So she will have to go into a home?
I said old days. The good news is, these days, it's eminently treatable.
Oh.
Have you any idea what an infestation of vermin can do to a hospital?
Yes.
And why wasn't I informed?
We thought we could deal with it.
And we are dealing with it, Matron. We've just hired a special piece of agricultural equipment and, well, they're only nesting in the cellar, and once we've destroyed the nests, we'll have it sorted, I promise.
I hope so, Ken. Otherwise, I shall have to inform the authorities. And quite apart from them wanting their own pest control people to deal with it, I would imagine they'll have a few questions to ask of you.
Oh,
ever want to get on that thing again.
You can't spend the rest of your life being scared, can you? Well, don't do it now. I never will.
Good morning, the Royal. Hang on a sec, I'll have to ask. Dr. Wetherill, it's Mr. Scripps, the undertaker. He's had some flowers delivered for Miss Gilbraith's funeral, but he thinks there might be a mistake.
All right, Lizzie, thanks. Hello, Mr. Scripps, Jill Wetherill speaking. Sorry, what's the problem? Right, and what exactly does it say on the card to go with him?
Oh, Dr. Omrod, your wife just rang. Can you pick up the children after the piano lessons? Because she won't be back till later.
She knows I'm on call.
All right, Mr. Scripps, yeah, leave it with me. Thanks. Brian Linson's just sent a dozen red roses to his girlfriend's funeral. And on the card he's written, "See you soon, darling."
This thing through its paces. No light,
no sound, nothing to love with you has left me peaceful. Mrs. Linton, are you sure? It's just that I'd quite like to talk to him. No, there's no problem. But if you could find out if Brian's at his friend's house and let me know, I would be very grateful. Okay, thank you. Bye-bye.
Gonna be all right?
With the crutches or with my wife?
Both.
I don't know. It's gonna be really strange, isn't it? I mean, I've spent the last year or so just cutting myself off from her, thinking it was something I just had to put up with.
Yes, well, you weren't to know, were you? You can't blame yourself for responding for things as you found them. The point is, even when things were at their worst, you didn't leave, did you? You didn't try to end your marriage.
25 years is a lot just to throw away. But it's not going to be easy.
No, it's not. She'll be on a lifelong regime of pills. But that smiling woman in the photograph, she will come back, Dennis. All you have to decide is whether you want to as well.
What's that they say? It's always better the second time around.
Yeah. Something like that.
Blimey, you didn't say there's going to be this much.
Well, I didn't know, did I? Listen, I'm going to go and check to see if I'm doing it properly.
You can have a go, yeah?
Right, OK, but listen, go down the end of that side or something. Keep it away from the wall.
Yeah, OK, I'm not a complete idiot.
Well, I'll call the coroner when I get back to the hospital.
I mean, I know it's my turn, but things are just a little bit problematic.
Well,
I'll return the favour whenever you like. It's just I've got an emergency on. Domestic variety.
Yeah, all right.
Thanks. I won't forget it.
It wouldn't be working if it didn't make all that much smoke, would it?
So it's okay then?
Yeah, of course it is. But there is one thing I forgot to tell you.
What's that?
Well, whatever else you do, keep it away from the drains. gas down there. It don't mix too well with the hot smoke and it tends to, you know, what? Well, it tends to explode.
Look, I'm awfully sorry.
It's all right. It's probably just one of those days.
It's just that, well, I'm still very new here. It's important that people see I'm willing to muck in.
Of course it is.
Perhaps we could go out another time.
Sure, excuse me. I'm gonna have to go and change.
You all right?
Hey, Alan. I've just heard that you're not supposed to use that machine anywhere near drains. Now, you haven't, have you?
Me? No, of course not. Why would I want to do a thing like that?
No, I got it wrong, didn't I? That's all there is to it.
Not necessarily.
No, Brian is dead because I didn't think that I had enough evidence to keep him here.
Well, isn't that fair enough?
No, it's not fair enough. I didn't look deep enough. As for Sister Bridget...
Now, you know it's not her fault. She was offering comfort the best way she knew how. Jill, Brian took a clear and positive decision to end his life because he wanted to be reunited with his fiancée. He'd have done it with or without you. Or Sister Bridget.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't know. When you're ready, I think Sister Bridget would appreciate a word from you. She isn't taking this very well. I'm sorry I pushed you for a decision on Brian, Dr. Wetherill. I know you weren't happy about it, but...
But you can't treat patients on gut instinct, can you?
No.
I'm just thinking about your case. Dennis and Betty Cording, that's the kind of case we'd all like, isn't it, eh? Two people in the most terrible situation. We prescribe some pills and it all turns out okay. God. Wouldn't it be lovely if all our cases could be solved that easily, eh?
Come on. Back into battle.
Bite your head off back there. I always get touchy when I'm wet.
Probably best not to go swimming with you, then.
Best not. Let's stick to the pictures, eh?
You here for greengrass?
Yeah, that's right.
Aye, well, I'm up, Kirk.
Merciful hour!
Hey.
You are in the bathroom that's reserved for use by patients.
Slip. It looks like you fractured your femur. That's a fiver.
I need to get her out as soon as possible.
You mean she could lose the leg?
She'd lose her life.